Welcome to the Blended Finance Project interview series, where we talk to international development and solidarity scholars, labor and civil society activists about the recent turn to so-called innovative finance for development in Canada. I'm your host, Susan Spronk, Associate Professor at the School of International Development and Global Studies at the University of Ottawa.
So I'd like to welcome Brian Tomlinson, who's the Executive Director of AIDWATCH Canada, which is an organization that looks at issues related to Canadian and global aid priorities, as well as global trends in the development effectiveness of civil society organizations. Before that, Brian worked for 16 years as a senior policy analyst, aid policy at the Canadian Council for International Cooperation. He's also an adjunct professor in the Department of International Studies at Dalhousie University. So welcome, Brian.
Thank you very much. Pleased to be here.
Great. So the first question we have is, what's the history of blended finance in Canada?
Well, strictly speaking, blended finance has a quite short history in Canada because our development finance institution was only created in 2018 with a grant of $300 million from the federal government. But, and we can talk about a bit more about what they do, but, you know, saying that, Canada's aid program has had a long history of working with the private sector as partners, particularly in agriculture and a number of other sectors. So blended is really a method of finance. It's not really a thing. It takes several forms. So FinDev Canada, as I said, was created in 2018. It's a relatively young organization, obviously. It's just getting going. It's getting some of its policies in place, more or less now that they are in place. But it's had, you know, a small record so far in terms of projects. So there's been 10 transactions or projects approved up to, I guess, actually this month. And most of those, actually 66%, two-thirds, are in climate finance, are in projects related to the mitigation of greenhouse gases in developing countries. But it has two other priority areas, one other being the empowerment, economic empowerment of women, and a more general one of economic development and job growth. So that's kind of a catch-all for anything else, really. But as I say, only 5 of the 10 transactions were in climate finance, two-thirds of the money is in climate finance. But that is only one of the mechanisms that Canada recently has been using for blending. The other one, which has substantially more money, about $1.3 billion, again, is in climate finance. And it is the special funds that Canada has created at the international financial institutions. So there are now 5 of them. There's 2 at the International Finance Corporation at the World Bank. And these are funds that Canada provides a grant to. But then the money is loaned to the private sector in various blended projects around the world. So there's 2 at the IFC, there's 1 at the Inter-American Development Bank, there's 1 at the Asia Development Bank, and then there is another special one, I guess, is at the World Bank. It's for coal-related energy transition and coal phase-out program, which Canada is a leading partner in, and that's also a blended fund. And then finally, in climate finance, Canada, as other donors, contributes to the Green Climate Fund. And that also has about 30 to 35% of its funding is with the private sector. Now, it doesn't describe it as blended, but it has all the characteristics that these other funds have. So in effect, it is blended too. So when you add it all up, you know, certainly in climate finance, it is the primary modality through which Canada supports mitigation. Probably, and I haven't checked this thoroughly, but at the Green Climate Fund, there probably is some adaptation projects that are approved there that are with the private sector, but certainly at all of the special Canada funds at the IF, at the World Bank, etc. This is not for adaptation. It's only for mitigation, more or less. So that's kind of where we're at now, and it's an evolving scene. Canada, like other donors, are giving more priority to this, but Canada isn't the major player here. I mean, France, Germany, Japan, Korea, as in the United States now, as donors, have far, far more substantial funding through this mechanism, both in total, obviously, because they're larger donors, but also as a share of their overall aid programs.
Great, thank you. So Brian, how much money would you say has been allocated to what are called blended financing initiatives or private financing initiatives? You mentioned, for example, that 30 to 35% of the Green Fund was private finance. So what would you say is happening in terms of the overall portfolio?
For Canada, you mean?
Yes, for Canada.
Yeah, I haven't added it up, but so it's $1.3 billion for the special funds that I mentioned. It's another $180 million through the FinDev Canada. And then the Green Climate Fund is about 35% of $600 million. So about, what's that? My math in my head isn't that quick, but it's kind of about $300 million there, I guess. So it all adds up to, I guess, $1.6 billion currently on the books and expanding, because Canada hasn't finished spending its climate finance commitment yet, and it's about to make a new commitment for the next period, 2021 to 25. And well, you know, we try to advocate against this. A good substantial part of that, I suspect, will be in these type of special funds, which will be mainly blended.
Cool. So we know from the European experience, as you mentioned, Canada's not the leader. You mentioned France as one of the countries that is seen more as a leader in blended financing initiatives. We know from these experiences that the money tends to go to middle-income countries as well as to sectors that are profitable, extractive, finance, manufacturing. What does the Canadian government propose to do to ensure that this money will go where it's needed most?
Well, this is a complicated issue to some extent. And yeah, I think, you know, you're right. All the evidence points to the fact that most of this money goes actually to lower middle income countries. It does go to upper middle income countries too, and it varies by fund, but a good substantial portion goes to lower middle income countries. At one level, this is understandable because these are essentially commercial transactions, and therefore they must be economically viable in those terms. So, you know, there is likely fewer opportunities of those nature in least developed countries. Nor do we necessarily want to burden least developed countries with debt. And so much of this money is actually loaned out to the private sector. Now, it's not sovereign debt, although sometimes the debt gets nationalized in developing countries. That happened in the last debt crisis. So, you know, it's how you define what is appropriate. To me, there is actually an argument, which I tend to support, that, you know, blended finance for mitigation, which essentially means building solar farms, wind farms, retrofitting buildings so that they're more energy efficient. I mean, these are generally initiatives that the private sector undertakes in Canada, and you know, there's no reason why the private sector wouldn't be the partner of choice in developing countries. But again, in countries where there is infrastructure. The issue really is, how do you assess the impact? Because these are programs that purport to say that, you know, they produce development outcomes. And certainly clean energy is a very important development outcome in today's world. But these projects, being largely infrastructure, also have, can have impacts on local people. So it's really the due diligence around those dimensions, in my view, that determines the appropriateness or not of this financial mechanism. So, for example, are human rights respected? Well, on paper, every agency says they respect human rights, but few of them have actually robust processes for free, informed, and prior consent, which is at the core of human rights in relation to infrastructure development. There are, you know, development principles that all the donors have signed on to, and you know, these include local ownership. Is the initiative part of the development plans of the country, of the community, of the region? Is there transparency? And this is a fundamental problem. I mean, Canada isn't the worst in this regard, although if you go on FinDev's website, you see all the projects, but you don't see the project documentation. You see kind of a three-line summary, and then in for some of the projects, a longer narrative about what they expect the impact to be. But you don't see whether they've done a gender analysis, for example, given Canada's feminist international foreign policy. Maybe they do one, but you know, it's not apparent on the site. So transparency is a very, very big issue here. That also, you know, they would come back to some degree saying, well, some of these are commercially guarded transactions, and therefore we can't kind of reveal kind of the detail of it, which is maybe fair enough, but there's substantial amounts of analysis that you could actually reveal, which is not being done. You know, and it can be done because the Asia Development Bank, which I mentioned, has a special fund from Canada. There, you can go on and see every project document. It's too much. You know, it takes you forever to go through it to get it all. But there, it's all on the internet and free to assess. So there are many ways that donors can improve their transparency in these areas. And then lastly, I think it's, you know, the danger of tied aid again. So, you know, this has been an issue, less so with Canada recently, but, you know, the fear is that for some donors, this is a way to retie a substantial part of their aid program to the private sector in the donor country. Now, to be fair to Canada, of the 10 projects, I looked at this, and only two actually have Canadian partners. So, you know, we're not actually guilty of that yet in terms of the of DFI, and the global funds that the IFIs have are governed by the procurement rules of those funds and are not tied to Canada. So I'm not saying that Canada is doing this, but certainly some of the bigger bigger donors like France and Germany, this is more of an issue. So yeah, these are some of the concerns that we have that would actually determine whether, you know, there is a development appropriateness here. And we don't know because there is very weak monitoring and assessment at this point across the board. Now, you know, Canada's only got a young agency, so you don't expect that instantly. But there's 168 blended finance agencies among the OECD countries. And there is very, very little evidence of detailed monitoring or even evaluation that has happened to actually demonstrate that they are living up to the very good principles that they've all enunciated, development principles, to really prove that, you know, this is actually making a development contribution.
Right. So one of the things that's inspiring the work that we're doing here in the interview is all these questions that you're raising in terms of there's a lot of unanswered questions around blending the initiatives. It's been tried elsewhere and now Canada's getting on board. What would you say are some of the alternatives to blended financing? As in, do we need blended financing? And if not, what should we be doing? So what do these alternatives look like?
As I said earlier, I mean, I think there is a role for the private sector in some aspects of development cooperation. Certainly, I would not suggest this mechanism if the primary goal is poverty reduction per se. Because there, you know, I think there aren't the kind of the commercial opportunities to actually include the private sector. And if they are there, they actually shouldn't be there, because we want the public sector to be handling basic services for poor and vulnerable populations. Now, the exception could be in agriculture, but even there, the Gates Foundation has had a major initiative in Africa, the Agra Initiative, to actually bring up the green revolution in Africa through involving the private sector. And all the evidence suggests that it's actually not been as effective as they suggested, and in some instances has not produced greater productivity of small-scale agriculture producers. So I'm just saying that to say that, the private sector may have a role, but it's not a primary role in development if the goal is poverty eradication. Because if the finance is concessional, then it does count as aid. And the rules about aid, everybody says, it's about poverty reduction, as it should be. But actually, the DAC rule about aid is about economic development and economic and social development. And it has to be concessional. So, mitigation properly done, integrated into, access to power by all populations or regulation around it, is not, in my view, an inappropriate use of the aid resource, because the aid resource in those projects are not the major finance. It is actually the private sector portion that is the bigger part of the finance. So the alternatives are grant finance and essentially focusing that grant finance in sectors and areas that are essential to raise people out of poverty. So the primary ones being health, education, and livelihoods for poor and vulnerable people, and but people who also are maybe employed, but not gainfully employed. And there are millions of those people around the world that are living on the edges of poverty that any economic crisis like the COVID pandemic is likely going to result in millions of people being reduced to conditions of poverty again, despite the fact that they have had some success in raising themselves out of poverty. So the private sector, I don't think, belongs in that type of programming. And that type of programming, in my view, should be the primary focus of our aid relationships. Some, to be fair, some of the blended finance is not aid. So if the money is not concessional, if it's not given at a reduced interest rate or as a grant, then it's counted as other public finance, international public finance. And there is actually another metric being developed called TOSD, Total Official Support for Sustainable Development. And this metric is meant to capture all of these transactions, whether they're concessional or not. And this will capture large amounts of blended finance that are provided by these financial institutions that don't qualify under the criteria for aid.
Great. So thank you so much, Brian, for sharing your thoughts with us.